7 minutes.
7 minutes. Actually, it's funny as you're saying about an audience of salespeople. And I don't think I've done as much prep for 7 minutes of presentation. I've done the whole thing, rehearsing in front of the mirror, the whole lot. So. Anyway, so I'll take you through what I'm going to cover. So I'm going to cover, well, really define what playbooks are and why these matter. One of the things that Notion and James asked me to talk about is something that I know has worked really well, which is where art and science really make sales work, and the science piece is really kind of playbooks. So I'm going to cover those, going to give you some examples, and then really talk about how to make them work and scale, whatever the size of business that you're in. So I just want to take a really quick straw poll in the audience here. So who is a kind of founder, CEO, legally? Okay. And who is a kind of like VP sales director, sales manager? And then individual salespeople?
Right.
Okay, thank you. That's, and then in terms of, when I say the word playbook, who would give themselves a 10 out of 10 going, this guy's got nothing to tell me, I know everything there is to know about playbook. Any kind of 9s or 10s out of 10? Good work. Okay. Come on. How about one? He's like, I don't even know what playbook is. Okay. And then the way I expect most people are is kind of in the middle somewhere, yeah? Okay, cool. Okay, so what I'm going to do, just to give you a little bit of context. So I've had 20 years in sales. All but one of those is in tech sales. In my first year of selling, I sold advertising space in the back of a magazine not far from here. And that was a weekly target, so it was a good kind of learning curve. I've done inside sales, channel sales, field sales, global account manager, and then I went into kind of sales leadership. I've managed teams from 6 people through to 160 people and businesses of sort of $6-7 million through to $125 million. So I've got kind of quite a broad breadth of experience. And one thing that's kind of hung true through all of those things is whether I knew it or not, playbooks made a difference into whether me and my teams were successful or not. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. And Notion Capital, who are one of our at Bright Pearl, Notion Capital, one of our kind of 3 main VCs that back us. I do little bits of work for them as well, helping out other portfolio companies. And one of the things that I keep ending up doing is helping them write playbooks to kind of really accelerate the business. So just a quick bit of background. So the origin of playbooks. So playbooks, if you've heard of them before, they normally come from sports. That's the kind, and they kind of mainly came from American football, where people wanted to explore, when they are doing defensive or offensive plays, as they call it, they're complex. Lots of people have multiple different roles, but everything needs to work together at the same time. And so what they did is they wrote this down in playbooks, and people had to learn them so that on the field they could make a call and everybody on that side would know what to do. And then the playbooks get more and more complicated as the defensive side hears that word and they go, okay, what are they doing? They're looking around and they have their own kind of defensive plays. When it comes to our business, our industry, playbooks, I looked this up, they're defined as business process workflows, which is really boring, isn't it? Really dull. So I prefer to look at them as playbooks being really defining where to play and how to win. And for me, you know, that's the kind of definition of, you know, why do we need them? Well, if you're an early stage founder, the passion for what you do and your expertise in the industry has got you so far. And you will win customers because of that expertise, that passion, that knowledge, and that ability to articulate an answer to a particular problem they've got. The challenge is, when you start hiring salespeople or sales leaders, you can't replicate that. You can distill it and you can package it, but you can't completely replicate it. So you have to have a means of being able to roll it out across other people. And that's where things like playbooks come in. They really kind of, as you get bigger and bigger organisations, and even the largest ones like Salesforce, for example, they all have playbooks that you know, their teams use, and there'll be playbooks based on kind of micro parts of a role. It gets more and more kind of granular as you get bigger and bigger. But the key part of playbooks is about capturing the knowledge and the expertise that sits within the team around how to go to market with a particular product or solution. Key thing with it, and I'll come back onto this later, the key thing with playbooks as well is you must train, test, coach salespeople with them, because the worst thing you can do with a playbook is print it off, have a nice big thick manual that sits on someone's desk, because that's exactly where it starts. They have to live, you have to adapt them consistently, and you have to keep training and testing people with this. That's if you're a leader or a business owner. If you're a sales guy, one of the reasons playbooks should matter to you is they help you ramp quickly. they are the thing that gets you past your quota quicker than anybody else, because you are taking all the skills, knowledge and expertise of other people, looking at it, learning it, and then applying that to your own, you're putting your own kind of sales spin on that, and it helps you accelerate. Okay, so how do you make them work? First of all, they have to be practice, not theory. It has to come from practical application and knowledge within the team, not someone sat in the room deciding, here's how I think we should be doing this. They have to live and be adaptable. You have to get contributions from the team. As soon as you start kind of rolling this out, if you just sat in the room and done it yourself, it won't work. There'll be people in your teams that know an awful lot more about a particular part of the business than you do. So you've got to really kind of use that knowledge and feed that in. And the number one thing, which I think people always forget, is you must start with the customer journey. Too often, people start with our sales process. Here's how we go to market with our product, our solution, our sales process. Here's how you forecast and so on. The playbook must start with the customer journey. Now, if you've done your work, you will have identified, you know, your ideal customer profile and the personas within that, and really how those customers research, select, buy, implement, and use your products. And from that, you can then start building So playbooks of sales, go to marketing, you can do the customer success and support. The key thing here is the format. The format must be consistent so you can keep rolling it out. Increasingly now, playbooks and playbook examples can be rolled into the sales CRM kind of stages as well. I talked about having the team contribute to that. If you're going to delegate this, delegate it via a template so that you give people the look and the feel of how it needs to come back to you, so that you can really kind of review and test that. And then, as I said, you've got to make sure you roll that out to everybody. So you must train people on this, and you must test it. Key way that I use of testing these things when you roll them out is do loads and loads of role plays. The first time you do, everyone hates role plays, right? The first time you do them, everyone's going, no, I'm not doing this. Within seconds, people really get into it, and you find these really emerging kind of characters that surprise you and kind of quite what they're like. But using role plays in whatever way else you've got of training them is absolutely key. It also means that if something goes wrong, quite often you can go back and people won't have followed the playbook there. And then once you've got those rolled out, the key thing is you must adapt and change. You will get better at what you do, and your playbook should adapt. The market will change, competition will change, pricing or regulation might change. You will need to constantly update and refine those and so on, and get more granular. But you must operationalize them. What I mean by that is make sure that they are part of your operational calendar so that you're consistently training and checking that people are following these. And you are then also, it goes back the other way, taking on board what you're doing. So, summary, focus on the customer journey, start with that. Then prioritise what you're going to do. Prioritise the playbooks that matter most. Get your team involved. Train, test and coach people on those. Make sure you operationalise them. And sellers, if you're individual sales guys, make sure you get involved as well. I've got 30 seconds for school. Yeah. Okay, thank you. So I'm a rugby coach in my spare time. I coach kind of junior rugby. And I realised the other day, actually, that's what I've been doing with, I'm kind of the attack coach and the backs coach. Years ago, when they were just beginning to want to do moves, I wrote down and gave pictures and that we learned all these different moves. And they got really good at them. And then the opposition got quite good at defending them. And then over time, I started getting them to kind of tweak them. And there's a couple of really big moments for me. When they started owning them and calling the moves themselves on the field, that was fantastic. When they then started asking to push the playbooks on and develop them more and feed in other things and bringing together different moves so that we could really mix up our attack, and then they started doing those on the field, it was fantastic. And so I kind of feel like I started something in motion with the playbooks, and then because we've done a good job as a coaching team, they started almost kind of developing their own playbooks and improving on those. So if you get this right at the start, you get the templates right, you get your team involved, and you get the outcomes right, people will really start taking those on and making them their own.